Whanganui. Is someone from Whanganui is watching? I've gotten in trouble from saying it like that, and I apologise. How should I say it?
Whanganui.
Whanganui, there you go. Not Whanganui. Whanganui sounds more fun. You can guarantee someone will be playing Strike Up the Band. Can I? I don't want to guarantee anything when it comes to brass band entertainment contests, because often they're not very entertaining at all. Although the Mighty Footscray Oval City Band did put together quite a good Beyonce Crazy in Love for the street march yesterday. They had the 2,000-plus crowd just... they were going for it. I mean, there were bands coming down and playing traditional march. There's a bit of Ravenswood, bit of Knight Templar. Then there was Beyonce Crazy in Love. The general public, who knew nothing about brass bands, were up in arms about it and absolutely loving it. Whanganui. Whanganui? Is that how I pronounce it? Thank you, Anonymous. It's okay. The agony of me talking to you is almost over. I'm sure the bands will be going on stage any second. Here they come now. Don't they look nice? Look at that tuba section. One, two, three, four, five, six tubas. I think that's the minimum number of tubas you should have in a band, at least six. It's a little bit awkward, the band standing up waiting for the conductor to come out, but they're coming out so slowly that half of them have sat down. Nope, they're just waiting for their row to come before they sit down as one. That looks nice, doesn't it? Good on them for presentation. And a special round of applause for the solo cornet, who decided to come out a little bit later than everybody else because he's really special. You'll be pleased to know that my lovely camera assistant is back on board for this set of live streaming, so we'll have some moving cameras and some close-ups of what goes on. Now, David Dobson is General Manager of Brass Bands New Zealand. I think he is. He's a boss-type person in the hierarchy of New Zealand banding anyway, and he'll be announcing what's going on. Unfortunately, I don't get a great sound feed of what he's saying because the microphones aren't hooked up, so I'll do a little bit of translating from his New Zealand English to my Australian English, and hopefully people in South Louisiana can still understand what's going on.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Heartland Building Society A-Grade Championships. The second day, of course...
Can you guys hear that on the stream?
...their own choice item. For any of you who may not have been here before or have not heard of Dr. Robert Childs, our adjudicator, permit me to read a little synopsis of this excellent fellow's life. Not long. Dr. Childs.
We're just hearing a little bit about Dr. Robert Childs. Naturally, he's done most things you can do with a brass band, including winning, I think, all the major competitions, as well as being a fantastic euphonium player.
He's the musical director of both the National Youth Brass Band of Wales and the very famous Cory Band. He's a founder and director of Doyen Recordings Limited, Performing Arts Education Limited, and Prima Vista Music Limited. He's a trustee and advisor to the Harry Mortimer Trust, a tutor and council member to the National Youth Brass Band of Great Britain, and a world-renowned euphonium soloist. In December 2002, Robert was awarded a doctorate in musical arts from the University of Salford. Robert is also an associate of the Royal College of Music, a fellow of the London College of Music, and has gained distinction in a master's degree from the University of Leeds. He holds a postgraduate certificate in education from the Open University, and as an education specialist, Robert frequently delivers masterclasses at universities and music institutions at home and abroad. Welcome, Robert, to this afternoon and this evening's presentations. I must ask that there be no photographs taken, that cell phones are turned off, please, and the video cameras must remain, if you are videoing, in one place. Please do not move around the auditorium. It's my privilege to introduce the first band on stage, you will notice that the presenter is Graham Dick. Graham is playing with a band. He's just come back from playing with his own band and will take over from me probably by the time of the next band. So, the band on stage is going to play variations on an enigma. This was commissioned by Howard Snell for the Desford Colliery Band and first performed by them in Gillingham, Dorset in England, in September 1986. The enigma is a short snatch of a phrase taken from a well-known brass band test piece, a phrase which caught the imagination of the composer, who took it as the basis of a sort of concerto for band, with each section featured in turn. First, the cornets have their turn with a molto ripetuo, and they are followed by the horns and flugel, whose variation is delicate and decorative. Trombones follow, each having their own tune in turn and then combining them together. Euphoniums and baritones have an expressive funeral march, which is interrupted by percussion and basses, who share a rhythmic syncopated variation. Climax is reached, and then this is followed by a fugue, which is based on the theme. The fugue heralds what turns out to be the theme on which all the variations are based, appearing in full at last, whose first five notes are derived from that enigma theme. The piece ends with an emphatic final statement by the timpani. Ladies and gentlemen, variations on an enigma.
There you go. This is Waitakere playing variations on an enigma. Hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, there you have it. That's Waitakere Band on stage. I think they actually call themselves the Trust Waitakere Auckland Brass. And they played Philip Sparks' Variations on an Enigma. I'm fairly sure that was the set work for the 2007 Australian Nationals in Brisbane, I think. Could have been 2008, though. A bit confusing. Anyway, hope you enjoyed it. What did you think? Some comments in there that the band was quite large. Six tubas. They didn't seem to make the noise you'd reckon six loud tubas could make, I would say, sitting here in the hall. And apologies on the stream, I'm not sure that you're getting the full effect of the bass end. It's pretty tough miking up the hall in here. Please give me comments on what you reckon the balance sounds like on the sound feed when you're getting it. Yeah, you're right, Anonymous. It probably does sound better in here than it does in the stream, although I'm doing my best for you. So any helpful feedback you can give me, I'll do my best to act on to improve things for you. Next band on stage is going to be band at number 4 in the program, who are Marlborough District Brass.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was Marlborough playing Journey to the Centre of the Earth, and the Tubers get stood up first. I quite like that. That's Gareth, usually plays with the Brisbane Excelsior, and well done, Flugelbell, you were very good as well. Now, look, loyal viewers, I'm afraid I've got to actually head off. Now I've got to get to the warm-up room so I can play with my own band. I'm going to leave all these cameras on quite a wide shot. I'll have to leave the audio levels so they'll be sounding good for the bands, so that means you won't be able to hear much of the announcer. But that's okay, I hope. Oh, look, I apologise in advance if anything crashes out in this stream. I won't be able to fix it back up until...
The Beer Bomb stage had chosen for their own choice item tonight Peter Graham's Journey to the Centre of the Earth. Written in 1864, Journey to the Centre of the Earth is on the surface an adventure story, but on a deeper level it can be seen as man's journey into himself, always probing deeper for what lies at the centre. The novel takes the form of a sequence of diary entries by Axel, nephew of Professor Otto Littenbrock. The pair follow coded instructions in an old document guiding them to Iceland, where together with their guide they enter the open crater of an extinct volcano, Snæfells, and pursue a trail to the centre of the earth. The music presents scenes from the novel in a chronological order. The work opens on the dark and brooding summit of Snæfells and follows the adventures as they descend into the bowels of the earth. En route, they encounter the wonders of the terrestrial depths, a dream sequence during which Axel witnesses a battle of antediluvian creatures, for the final ascent and homecoming. The key scene of the book and the music reflects on Axel's despair as he becomes separated from his companions and is lost in the labyrinth. His subsequent rescue is due to an acoustic phenomenon whereby he hears the voices of his friends in the Whispering Gallery. Peter Graham's Journey to the Centre of the Earth. band on stage have chosen for their own choice Harmony Music by Philip Spark. Harmony Music was written for the championship section of the National Brass Band Championships of Great Britain in 1987. It opens quietly with a long unison crescendo interrupted by the basses, which in turn introduces a cornet fanfare, leading to a chorale-like episode building from the lower half of the band to a huge tutting. There is a brief hint of faster music to come, which fails to dispel a high haunting euphonium solo before the main molto vivace arrives. This reaches a climax and subsides gradually into the slow central section, a homage to Maurice Ravel, which incorporates accompanied cadenzas for cornet and horn. The opening of the piece returns and leads back to an abbreviated recapitulation of the vivace. When it appears to be hurtling to a close, the trombones and soprano introduce a brief moment of chaos before a presto coda asserts itself. Harmony Music by Philip Spark. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for chatting in. I hope the chat behaved itself while I was away too. Watching the live streaming in London. Polaris should be on, I think, around 8:30 p.m. local time, but things are running ahead, so I'd be ready from any time from about 7:45 onwards. They're the last band on tonight. Happy birthday to Stuart.
The band on stage have chosen for their own choice Tellus Variations.
This is Tellus Variations.
These variations are based as the third of nine that Thomas Tellus wrote in 1567 as part of a psalter for the first Anglican Bishop of Canterbury. It was later used by Vaughan Williams in the English hymnal and as the basis for his Fantasia. After a turbulent introduction, the first half of the theme is stated by the middle of the band. Variation one is based on the first two notes of the theme, exploring the E minor tonality with repeated semi-quaver activity. Variation 2 contains a gentle solo for flugelhorn and a varied statement of the theme in choral form. Variation 3 starts with a series of short solos before a serene melody appears on cornet. The theme then appears reharmonized before the variation closes peacefully. The final variation starts with cornet fanfares and evolves around a fugue-like theme first presented by the euphoniums. Eventually, music from Variation 1 returns to herald the final, fiery statement of the theme, accompanied by figures from the fugue. But the piece ends quietly, the serene beauty of the Tellus chorale unshakable. Tellus Variation.
Thank you.
jacket with the black lapels, black shirt, and the silver tie. We also have a tuba player, who I believe his wife was watching yesterday, who's staying in the room next to me, doing our best to get him up with some close-ups. North Shore had a very good performance yesterday in the test piece. Definitely up there in the reckoning to take home the competition. We'll see how they go today. And just to clarify, after the final band plays today, there'll be a break of probably about half an hour, 45 minutes, while I count up all the points and all of that. Following that, we will be live streaming the results. So stay on so you can watch. Look, there we have Kerry.
Band on stage, they've chosen for their own choice, A Tale as Yet Untold.
Can you hear that, live stream viewers?
This was commissioned by the Corey Band for the 2010 European Brass Band Championships. And composer Philip Spark makes the following introductory notes. The theme of the work, which is set in three movements, takes as its subject the power of the human spirit to overcome adversity and how the beauty of music can help in this request. The first movement opens with a nervous, repetitive figure in the corners, under which an impassioned theme develops. This is cut short by a closely related faster section, which comprises two alternating moves, an aggressive toccata interspersed by a yearning 6/8 melody. The second movement is the heart of the work and symbolises the ability of the human soul to overcome the storm and stress of the first movement with a sense of optimism. The third movement tries to negate this feeling of peace, but ends triumphantly in a salute to the power of the human spirit. Philip Spark's A Tale as Yet Untold.
I hope you enjoy the performance. Alan Clemmers, the pro, says Woolston, North Shore, Polaris. So it seems to be pretty set with that top three. Oh, we have some news. Someone's talking
ladies
up the front.
Can I have your attention for a moment, please? It's time to commence with the formalities. It's an essential part of any contest before we hear the results. My pleasure to welcome to the stage Diane Steinhausen, who's the president of your association. Mr. Ian Powell, who's the organising chairman of the Heartland Organising Committee. Mr. Kevin Softer, who is the funding manager for Heartland Building Society, the major sponsor. A person who needs no introduction, Tony Cowan. Billy Middleton from Malto Music. And if Megan Evans is in the audience, if she could also come forward. And we have a representative from the New Zealand Army Band who will also be presenting some awards. Any event such as this
I want to thank the other people that have travelled here, particularly the adjudicator, Dr. Robert Childs, presenter Graham Dick, and supervisor Stephen Leader. And I have a couple of bottles of wine here, one for Graham and one for Stephen, if they'd like to come to bed. Thank you.
So well done to the organising committee on organising what's been a pretty fun contest so far. That speech wasn't too painful now, loyal viewers, was it? Could have been much, much worse. This is an unusual situation we have, waiting for brass players to pick up some grog on stage.
Hi. I'd like to start off by thanking our volunteers. And you need to applaud really loud for them. These are the judges for the solo ensembles, the door people, the accompanists, the supervisors, the marching judging team. If they weren't here, we wouldn't be here. And they travel at their own expense and pay for their own accommodation. So, you know, they're not a burden on the funding that we receive. Thank you to Heartland for sponsoring the A-grade band, a test, and also... thank you to the band supporters, and why you might ask that. Well, today at the C grade, I had a really heartwarming experience. I was sitting listening to the C grade, and the Woolston A grade band walked en masse into the C grade to support their C grade band. And it's just such an amazing feeling when you feel that. I tapped Graham Bremner on the shoulder and I said, "It's just so amazing, I can't believe it." I had tears in my eyes, it was so good. That's the support within our movement. It's just amazing, and I thank you very, very much. And while I'm speaking about support, on the street march today, apart from our cold feet, the mayor was dancing. She was absolutely delighted. She was so thrilled. It was an amazing spectacle coming down the street, just where we were standing. And I know that a lot of you don't like marching, but believe me, that crowd really appreciated your effort out there and the fact that you probably were out marching in cold, miserable weather, practicing before you arrived here. So look, thank you for that. It's appreciated. To Ian and his Heartland team, thank you for the achievement and the hard work, all done at very short notice. Here I'd like to acknowledge Christchurch. We do think about you and aware that you are having stalled difficulties. I know that I wanted the contest in Christchurch, but sadly that wasn't to be. It was necessary that we relocated it. But thank you to Ian and his team for the remarkable short time frame in putting this contest together. Ian, I've got a small gift for you. Gift is the engraved glasses that we do hand out at contest time. Being in a provincial town makes it, we're all really close together. We've got accommodation really close, we're on top of one another, and it all makes for a good feeling within the band, and there's lots of camaraderie. We were out last night trying to find somewhere where there wasn't a band's person. That was extremely difficult to do because you were all out there supporting Timaru, and that was fantastic. Thank you. And that's all from me. Thank you very much once again, and I wish you all the best for your results tonight.
I should also acknowledge at this stage too that the chairman of the organising committee, Ian Powell, is involved with Alpine Energy, who were the major sponsors of the street march, so they deserve a round of applause. At the Champion of Champions on Thursday night, there were two special presentations. Each year, the Brass Bands Association calls for nominations for the Administrator of the Year and the Accompanist of the Year. Unfortunately, the Accompanist of the Year had a busy day and was away home and wasn't there to receive her presentation. So I'd like to ask Betty Bremner to come to the stage, please. We don't give you away that lightly. We need just to read a little bit of the history and what she has contributed to this organisation of ours. She first started playing as accompanist in 1971 for a person called Trevor Bremner. And she's devoted her life to accompanying soloists, devoted her life to working with them to achieve that perfect combination. And that only comes with patience, dedication and commitment. At this contest, she has played for 11 soloists. A few weeks ago at the Central Districts contest, she played for 23. And only 2 weeks ago in the local music competitions, she played for 18. So a totally deserved winner and recipient of our Accompanist of the Year. Moving through our special prizes, each year there is a special award for the Dunedin Ladies Trophy, which is awarded to the woman gaining the highest score in open solos. And this year we have a tie, and the recipients will have to share it for 6 months of the year each. Jessica Hicks from Leopard's Coachline Canterbury Brass. And Lisa Rogers from Hamilton City Road. Which is an annual one, is the Pat Cole Medal, awarded to the youngest winner of an open solo, and this year goes to Hamish Upton from Wollstone Brass. Pleasure to welcome to the stage now our Chief Musical Adjudicator, Dr. Bob Chalmers. We will get a chance to speak to you in a moment, but firstly we need to proceed with the results for the Parade of Bands and award those prizes, and then it will be his opportunity. So I'll call on Stephen Leader to announce the results from the parade event.
Here we go.
This is for the A grade street march. In third place was Marlborough District Brass. Second place, Leopard Coachlines Canterbury Brass. And the champion A grade marching band for this year is Wollstone Brass with drum major Graham Bremner. We have a representative of Wollstone. Graham, would you like to stay on the stage? Present the Tony Cowan Cup to the champion drum major, Graham Bremner of Wolston, and we'd ask Tony to carry out that task.
I'm just taking a liberty here, folks, and I hope you don't mind, but I'm in Timaru, and I would just like to pay a tribute, special tribute to the late Duffy Manning, who passed away just recently. He was an icon amongst drum majors. He was one of the drum majors of his time, and I know there's a lot of us here tonight, including Graham, who has suffered at Duffy's hands. Him and I were fierce competitors, and I certainly learned a lot from him. So I just wanted to take a moment and say how thrilled I am to see that the Timaru Band have, in fact, produced a trophy in memory of Duff Manning. That's really quite special. Thank you.
It's now my pleasure to welcome to the microphone Dr. Robert Childs. Well, thank you very much. I was going to say thank you for that enthusiastic applause. I hope it's going to be the same after the results, but it wasn't really that enthusiastic, was it? I've heard 9 super bands today, and the thing is, they all played music that they liked and that they could play, unlike the test piece, which, you know, had like 6 cadenzas in it and 24 solos and a couple of duets, and put one or two of their players in the spotlight when they used to sit in the background. So today was much more enjoyable for me, but it was a tighter contest. Before I go on to talk about the music, I'd like to thank the organisers for inviting me back to New Zealand. I think it's a fantastic country, and you've got a great tradition, and the standard with the top bands here today would stand up in any national contest anywhere in the world. Really top class playing. Thank you very much. But obviously, to get me and my son over to New Zealand is an expensive affair, and I wanted to thank Besson Musical Instruments for helping us with some sponsorship. So thank you very much to Besson Musical Instruments. I wanted to explain as well my system of marking in terms of the sacred item. I always think that when bands have spent literally 8 hours per minute on the test piece and the own choice pieces, that for the sacred piece to have such a weighting in the competition is sometimes it's a bit sad. And so my spread of marks in the sacred item is no more than 5 over the whole of the 9 bands. What it means is it reflects the 100 marks that I've got, as opposed to the 150 that I have for the own choice and the test piece. In both those sections, I've spread marks over something like 18 marks. So there's a big weighting towards the test piece and the own choice piece. I hope you agree with that. And if you don't, it's tough. Talking about breath of souls, as I said, 6 really, really tough cadenzas. Solos for the euphonium, 2 solos for the euphonium, cornet, duets. It was interesting that lots of the cadenzas in some bands were played very well, with 1 or 2 that were unfortunately had major accidents in. I can't ignore that, obviously. So there might be some discrepancies between today's result and yesterday's competition, but that is all based on what I hear. You know, if a band had good soloists, obviously there's other things to it, like the ensemble, range of dynamics,
And the factor of lifting those hairs on the back of the hand or at the back of the neck, if a band can do that, that's truly important. I was looking though at the Breath of Souls and thinking to myself, I didn't mind bands going particularly fast or faster than marked, or if they were a little bit slow, provided that the second time that the fast section came, it was faster than the first time. The first time is marked 150 to 160, the second time is marked 168 or something like that. So the composer wanted a difference. So if you played it very fast in the beginning, provided that you played it faster with clarity at the end, you're okay. You could think about that. I thought that on lots of occasions is the percussion, I mean the percussion requirements of that piece was immense, and generally speaking, there was a really, really high standard of percussion playing in this contest, and actually in the B section as well. But there were times today and in the test piece where the percussion obliterated the brass parts. Now, of course, that might well have been a ploy by the conductor to hide some of the detail that maybe wasn't there. And if that was the case, then he succeeded. But I was looking for a good balance, and many times the percussion was too loud, especially the side drum. It was interesting with the cadenzas again that many people got their top notes, and then once the hard bit was done, they split a note on the way back down. That's the old saying, you know, when is a football team at its most vulnerable? And it's when they've just scored a goal. So once you've got that really high note and you're tapping yourself on the back saying, well done, remember it's not over until you get back down again. Because there was a lot of little falls. One of the words I used a lot when I was judging Breath of Souls was bluffing. Bandsman's bluff. There seemed to be quite a lot of that going on. I would say you're almost as good as that as we are over the sea there. It is an art form, but don't forget, it's difficult to bluff a bluffer and one. Okay? So I did recognise that. I think it was difficult. Now when we go on to the own choice pieces, it comes right back down to the same argument. Should you play an easy piece very well, and a difficult piece with a few flaws in it? What am I going to go for? Well, I've gone for the performance, the best performance, the cleanest performance, performances that was musical. Today we have pieces like easier pieces, like Journey to the Centre of the Earth and Talus Variations, comparatively easy compared to From Ancient Times and Titan's Progress, probably the two most difficult pieces in the repertory at the moment. But I'm going to judge the performance, not the pieces. So, I'm going to leave you with that thought. Thank you very much.
I've got two special acknowledgements to do. I stand here as president, but I have an amazing team that support me and support me. Some support lots more at contest time because others are playing. But my support at contest are Evan Sayer and my support through the year, Robert Wilson, Jeff Mulroney, John Sullivan, Kathy Bennett, and I hope I haven't forgotten somebody, which would be really terrible. But they're there, they're supporting me. You see me, but they're in the background, and I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them. So can we just acknowledge the support of the EMC? And my next acknowledgement, and most of you will know about this, we've bought a gift for our adjudicators, and you've had an input in this, and you've signed it off, and made your comments to Bob, and like to present this.
I'll now call on Stephen Leader as the supervisor to read the results for the sacred item.
Thank you, folks. Now what you've all been waiting for. I will start with the sacred item, and I will read it out in program order. Draw a program one, Ascot Park Hotel Brass of Invercargill, 93. Draw two, Footscray Yarraville, 93. Draw three, Leopard Coach Lines Canterbury Brass, 93. Draw four, Marlborough District Brass Band, 93. Draw five, North Shore Brass, 94. Draw six, Flora's Trust Wellington Brass, 95. Draw seven, St Kilda Brass, 93. Program eight, the Trust Waitakere Auckland Brass, 94. Program nine, Wilson Brass, 95. That means that in third equal place with North Shore Brass and Trust Waitakere Auckland Brass, first equal Pelorus Trust Wellington Brass and Woolston Brass.
Would a representative of those two bands come forward, please?
Test point, program one, Ascot Park Hotel Brass of Invercargill, 138. Program two, Footscray Yarraville, 134. Program three, Leopard Coach Lines Canterbury Brass, 140. Program four, Marlborough District Brass, 139. Program five, North Shore Brass, 142. Program 6, Pelorus Trust Wellington Brass, 146. Program 7, St Kilda Brass, 135. Program 8, the Trust Waitakere Auckland Brass, 136. Program 9, Woolston Brass, 145. In third place, North Shore Brass, second, Woolston Brass, third,
if you have a representative of the band to receive the Norman Doffin Memorial Trophy. Other awards relating to the test selection, and we'd like to ask Bob Charles to present these. There is a special award for the outstanding soloist in the A grade test selection. The 2012 winner of the Elgar Clayton Memorial Trophy is David Mallett from Leopard Coach Lines. Upstairs. those of you who don't know, he's a euphonium player. There's also one further trophy relating to the test selection, and we'd like to call on Billy Middleton of Montauk Music to present this trophy in memory of Jack McDonnell as the to the best section in the test piece. And the 2012 winner of the trophy is the percussion section at Woolston Brace. Proceed with the results for the own choice.
Once again, I will read these results in program order. Program 1, Ascot Park Hotel Brass of Invercargill, 136. Program 2, Footscray Yarraville, 139. Program 3, Leopard Coach Lines Canterbury Brass, 134. Program 4, Marlborough District Brass Band, 131. Program 5, North Shore Brass, 142. Program 6, Polaris Trust Wellington Brass, 144. Program 7, St Kilda Brass, 140. Program 8, the Trust Waitakere Auckland Brass, 132. Program 9, Woolston Brass, 146. In third place, North Shore Brass, second chorus, Trust Wellington, in first place, Woolston Brass.
We have a representative to receive the Mervyn Walters Memorial Cup. We also wish to present to the winning conductor the Merv Waters and the BBANZ Cup. We have a new award in the own choice selection. It's the Gil Evans Memorial Trophy, and I'd like to ask the representative of the family, Megan Evans, who's in the wings behind us, to present this. And this is awarded to the principal cornet in the A grade choice selection, obviously selected by Bob Chalk. And the award this year goes to Kevin Hickman.
And I'm honoured to be here with my family today to present this new trophy for the A-grade own choice piece in honour of my grandfather, Gil Evans. At his funeral, one of New Zealand's premier corner players, Trevor Bremner, played a specially written Ken Young piece entitled For Gil, for the man who was a musician in every sense of the word. He picked up a corner at the age of 7 when he joined the Auckland Waterside Junior Band and did not put it down until his sudden departure from us. He was part of the 1962 National Band in New Zealand, which won the World Championships in the Netherlands. I personally love looking through the photos of this time, my grandfather standing tall and graceful, and all of them with his infectious smile beaming. He joined the New Zealand Symphony Orchestra alongside my beautiful grandmother Sharon, but his involvement with all things brass continued. While with the NZSO, he still tutored trumpet at the Victoria University and as the brass tutor for the National Youth Orchestra. On his retirement from the orchestra, he spent the next 15 years as a musical director and conductor of brass bands throughout the Wellington region, as well as adjudicating at many local and national band championships. Even in his last month, his thoughts were not of himself, but not being able to attend his position at Hutt Valley International Boys School as their brass instrument teacher. He always gained great pleasure from being involved with youth bands and honouring the skills of musicians young and old. His love of music, which is one that is seen all through our family, and I was fortunate as a young child to be able to travel with my grandparents on many brass band and orchestra events. Even when I became more interested in modern music rather than brass or classical, Grandad was always the first to listen to it, give me his musical opinion, and always our taxi driver when we needed picked up from concerts or gigs. Arriving beaming in his car, at whatever odd hour it may have been, wanting to know all about what had gone on, and then would greet us in the kitchen in the morning with the review or cutout from the paper, and I only wish that our sore heads had been able to show how much it was actually appreciated. Even teaching my husband to dance a waltz to a blind spot song for our wedding. Grandad was never a man to blow his own horn, and as a family, we have all been deeply affected by his far too early departure from us. He would have loved to have been here with you all this week, not only making the most of his time with his great-grandchildren, but enjoying the amazing calibre of performances that have been on show and sharing it all with you. I know that he is here with us, boom, boom, booming, quietly and enjoying the celebrations, but we would love to celebrate your granddad, and in donating and presenting this trophy, we know that he will never be forgotten and his beaming smile and amazing talent will stay with us always. And congratulations, and it's with great pleasure that we present the Gil Evans Memorial Cup.
In case you haven't worked it out already, I will now go through the aggregate. Once again, starting with Program 1, Ascot Park Hotel Brass of Invercargill, 367. Number 2, Footscray Yarrable, 366. Number 3, Leopard Coach Lions Canterbury Brass, 367. Number 4, Marlborough District Brass Band, 363. Number 5, North Shore Brass, 378. Number 6, Chloris Trust Wellington Brass, 385. Number 7, St Kilda Brass, 368. Number 8, the Trust Waitakere Auckland Brass, 362. Number 9, Austin Brass, 386. So in third place, North Shore Brass. Second, Chloris Trust Wellington Brass. The winner, Austin Brass.
I'd like to call on Dr. Charles to present the New Zealand Champions Gold Cup to Wolfson Brass.
I'd just like to thank the boys and girls from Wolfson. Every year you put the hard yards in, and you deserve this. Thank you.
Thank you, Cooper. Also to present to the conductor of the Champion Agro Band, the KGL Smith Memorial Trophy. As you'll appreciate, that concludes the 2012 Heartland Building Society Championships. A big thank you to Timaru for putting this on at such short notice. Look forward to seeing you all in New Plymouth next year. Remember tomorrow, Band of the Year competition here, and scores and CDs of the recordings are on the back of the stage to collect. Thank you very much.
Well, loyal viewers, how did you go? I think we were pretty solid with our top three, Wolston, Wellington and North Shore. Congratulations to all the band. Thanks very much for joining in and watching the live stream. Hope you enjoyed it. Sorry that I did turn off the live chat there towards the end. I didn't see much point in chatting about results that are happening. If you want to have a chat, I think there's a bunch of brass band forums and the like around the place where you can have your 2 cents worth on the overall result. Thanks for watching. Keep in touch. Follow the Facebook page. It's facebook.com/brassband. I've also got a Twitter account, twitter.com/brassband. You can email me if you want. Very happy to hear from anyone with any comments about the live streaming. Email address is awesome@brassband.com. I'll be streaming tomorrow as well. Tomorrow is the Band of the Year contest, an invitational-only entertainment contest featuring three bands starting from 2 p.m. local time. We're GMT plus 12 here. So it's probably like, I don't know, 4 or 5 a.m. for you guys in the UK. Probably not quite as bad for you guys in the US. Hope you've enjoyed the stream. Thanks for being part of it. And I'll see you tomorrow. Please send me an email or Facebook me. Bye.